Thank you, Professor Salzman, Adam, Alexander Hamilton Society, Duke University. I'm very honored to be here tonight. How does a bastard orphan, son of a whore and a Scotsman, dropped in the middle of a forgotten spot in the Caribbean by Providence, Congress, and squalor, grow up to be a hero and a scholar? A $10 founding father without a father got a lot farther by working a lot harder, by being a lot smarter, by being a self-starter. By 14, they placed him in charge of the trading charter. And every day, while slaves were being slaughtered and carted away across the waves, he struggled and kept his guard up. Inside, he was longing for something to be a part of. The brother was ready to beg, steal, borrow, or barter. Then a hurricane came, devastation reigned. A man saw his future dripping down the drain. Put a pencil to his temple, connected it to his brain. He wrote his first refrain, a testament to his pain. Then the word got around. They said, this kid's insane. Man took up a collection just to send him to the mainland. Get your education, don't forget from which you came. And the world's gonna know your name. What's your name, man? Alexander Hamilton. My name is Alexander Hamilton. There's a million things I haven't done, but just you wait, just you wait. When he was 10, his father split, full of it, dead ridden. 2 years later, see Alex and his mother bedridden, half dead, sitting in her own sick, sent thick. Alex got better, but his mother went quick. Moved in with the cousin committed suicide, left him with nothing but ruined pride, something new inside, a voice saying, Alex, you gotta fend for yourself. He started retreating and reading every treatise on the shelf. There would have been nothing left to do for someone less astute. He would have been dead or destitute without a cent of restitution. He started working, clerking for his late mother's landlord, trading sugar cane and rum and all the things he can't afford. Scamming for every book he can get his hands on. Planning for the future, seeing now as he stands on the bow of a ship, headed for a new land. In New York, you can be a new man. Alexander Hamilton, we are waiting in the wings for you. You can never back down. You never learn to take your time. Alexander Hamilton, when America sings for you, will they know what you overcame? Will they know you rewrote the game? The world will never be the same. Ship is in the harbor now. See if you could spot him, another immigrant coming up from the bottom. His enemies destroyed his rep. America forgot him. There's a million things I haven't done, but just you wait. Alexander Hamilton. That, in case you don't know, is the opening number. Broadway Slut, smash it, Hamilton and American musical. Composed by Lin-Manuel Miranda, based on the biography that Adam mentioned by Ron Chernow, with Alexander Hamilton. Tonight I'm going to be integrating many aspects of this musical into my presentation. Just by show of hands, how many have either seen or just heard the music? All right, nice crowd. My goal tonight is to have you walk out of here remembering at least three things. One, Hamilton was a self-made man and hero. George Washington's most trusted aide. I'm going to cover many of their heroic achievements. Number two, America at its best is Hamiltonian. What do I mean by that? Pro-constitution, pro-finance, pro-industry, pro-immigrant, anti-slavery, anti-foreign entanglement. And number three, Hamilton's legacy. What is it? I guarantee you'll walk out of here knowing that answer. Now, Hamilton as a self-made man, the intro clearly shows that that's what he was. And frankly, what he overcame and how he rewrote the game is the stuff of legends. However, because Hamilton was such a controversial and prolific figure whose life was cut short, many of his opponents outlived him by decades, and they had a chance to rewrite his story, portraying him as a monarchist, an elitist, or embezzler of the treasury funds. Since Hamilton was often the youngest and smartest guy in the room, he was usually envied. And because he was the immigrant son of an unwed mother, he was taunted as a Creole bastard, and his patriotism was doubted. These mythological portrayals of his character and impact became so popular that they're actually one theme in the musical, captured in the verse, who lives, who dies, who tells your story. It was actually the off-Broadway play. Alexander Hamilton was larger than life, a visionary who saw ahead of the curve. Brave, bold, confrontational, and unconventional. A brilliant writer and a passionate speaker. A thinker and a man of action. And in defense of liberty and the Constitution, he was as effective with a pen as he was with a musket. Hamilton never appealed to populist pandering, the politicians we see today. But instead, he chose a persuasive power of reason. Let's look at some of the essential facts of his life. In 1757, Hamilton was born on a tiny Caribbean island called Nevis. He was born out of wedlock and into poverty. When he was young, his father abandoned the home. And a few years later, his mother died in bed right next to him with yellow fever. Now an orphan, he worked as a clerk for a import-export firm, where he mastered trading and calculated different foreign currency exchange rates in his own head, and thus began a lifelong respect for honest business. When a hurricane devastated the island that he lived on, he wrote his way out of poverty by penning a description of the event that was so emotional that local merchants chipped in to send him to America for schooling. At age 17, he started at King's College, which is now Columbia University, but he dropped out in order to fight in the Revolutionary War. In March 1777, at age 20, anyone here age 20? Okay, he met and became George Washington's principal and most trusted aide. Last time I came down to Duke back in January when I met Adam, sweetheart Carrie Ann and I drove right from here to Mount Vernon, and I took this picture. This is one of my favorite pictures in Mount Vernon. In 1781, Hamilton became a battlefield hero during the British surrender at Yorktown. After the war, he served as a lawyer, defending freedom of speech, and representing the defense during America's first murder trial. Most of New York lay in ashes after 7 years of British occupation. But in 1784, Hamilton co-founded the Bank of New York, which is the oldest existing bank in America. That got the city literally back in business. A staunch abolitionist, he helped to found the New York Manumission Society, which eventually led to slavery being abolished in New York. At age 30, he was a primary organizer at the Constitutional Convention, where he spoke tirelessly in defense of that new document. And then he spearheaded a pro-Constitution principled defense by writing 51 of the 85 Federalist Papers, which eventually led to ratification of the Constitution. Called on by Washington a second time, now to be his first Treasury Secretary, Hamilton's fiscally sound, pro-business, pro-banking policy set up America to go from bankruptcy to prosperity, first by reducing huge war debt. He saw industrialism and commerce as the leading factors in America's future. Hamilton advocated a foreign policy of American self-interest by recommending neutrality during the French Revolution, as opposed to becoming entangled in senseless foreign wars. He also got caught up in the first sex scandal. Hamilton either had his fingerprints on or he founded these institutions which still are around today. U.S. Coast Guard, New York Post, Customs House, West Point Military Academy, New York Stock Exchange. In 1804, at age 47, he was killed in a duel with Aaron Burr. Consequently, he did not live to see the American glory that came by applying his principles. The bond forged between the wise, experienced Washington and the young, skillful Hamilton was synergetic, sometimes volatile, and lasted successfully for 22 years. Their acts of heroism and trust began in the war and continued in peace. In the musical, as we see British soldiers killing Americans, the ominous music of the song Right Hand Man prepares us for the next step in Hamilton's ascent. He says, as a kid in the Caribbean, I wished for a war. I knew that I was poor. I knew it was the only way to rise up. If they tell my story, I'm either gonna die on the battlefield in glory or rise up. and we sense the tension as the chorus sings. Here comes the general, rise up. And then Hamilton continues, I will fight for this land, but there's only one man who can give us a command. And then bursting front and center, the moment we've been waiting for, George Washington says, we are outgunned, outmanned, outnumbered, outplanned. I'm gonna need a right-hand man. And we sense the desperation in the situation as the British are about to take over New York for the next 7 years. Washington sees all the soldiers retreating in panic, and he says, are these the men with which I am to defend America? We ride at midnight, Manhattan in the distance. Cannot be everywhere at once, people. I am in dire need of assistance. Meanwhile, on the other side, we see Hamilton. He's not abandoning his post. He's staying his ground. And then he actually even goes on the offensive and steals British cannons. Washington finds out about this and summons Hamilton to his quarters. Washington says to him, it's all right, you want to fight? You've got a hunger? I was just like you when I was younger. Head full of fantasy, dying like a martyr. Dying is easy, young man. Living is hard. Then the general presents the situation more eloquently. He says, I'm being honest. I'm working with a third of what our Congress has promised. We are a powder keg about to explode. I need someone like you to lighten the load. And he offers Hamilton the pen to sign on as his aide-de-camp. Hamilton hesitates at first because he wants to fight. He doesn't want to write. But then he knows that this is his shot at ascending. And he takes the pen and he puts his mind to work, offering solutions to being outgunned, outplanned, outnumbered, and outmanned. And then the chorus builds up, rise up, here comes the general. And Washington is grateful now to see that he has somebody that he can totally trust. And he concludes, and his right-hand man. In an effort to stay alive, we reach Valley Forge, winter 1777, at rock bottom during the Revolutionary War. Barefoot, shivering in the snow, soldiers are ready to mutiny. And Hamilton reflects, I have never seen the general so despondent. I have taken over writing all his correspondence. Congress writes, George, attack the British forces. I shoot back, we have resorted to eating our horses. What's happening? Both Washington and Hamilton understand that Congress that has 13 separate, often conflicting, though independent states cannot last if they're not united. And the two agree that a stronger federal central government with a specific purpose, defending individual rights, is the way to go. And a full 10 years before it would actually happen, they are planting the seeds for the Federalist Papers and the U.S. Constitution. This is what's happening during the war. Now, another point during the war, Hamilton, Washington, and the Marquis de Lafayette, who's also a hero in the musical, as he was in real life, they are camped out in a place in New Jersey, which is now called Patterson. And Hamilton sees this 70-foot waterfall, and he says, basically he's brash youngster, and he tells Washington, after we win this war, we have to harness that power and build an industrial society. And sure enough, after they did win the war, that's what happened. That's what this refers to here. And there's a statue of the three heroes, which is in Morristown, New Jersey. Finally, the tide turns in the war. Hamilton, who has wanted to fight and not write for years, it's 1781, and Washington gives him the battlefield command at Yorktown. But the general first recounts his own previous failures and the endless criticism that he's endured under the spotlight. He says, let me tell you what I wish I'd known when I was young and dreamed of glory. You have no control who lives, who dies, who tells your story. I know that we can win. I know that greatness lies in you. But remember, from here on in, history has its eyes on you. Hamilton charges the battlefield, eludes enemy fire, demonstrates that inner greatness that leads his troops to the decisive victory as the British surrender. We are now ready for the emergence of a new nation. America is born out of the Enlightenment. Radical ideas such as individualism, liberty, awesome power of reasoning mind and the rights of man. We're smashing stale notions of divine right of kings, monarchy, superstition, and conventional wisdom. Hamilton captures this mood in the Federalist Papers' first essay when he asks whether societies are capable of establishing good government from reflection and choice or accident and force. So here he's making a distinction from Europe, where just about all the countries came into existence by some kind of conquest and force. Saying, no, America will be different. We will go by reason. Before America was created, the individual lived on his knees as a subject of the king, the church, the state, or some ethnic tribe. The founders recognized the individual as a sovereign entity who possessed rights. Therefore, it's no longer necessary to live on your knees. In the song, My Shot, we see this American theme when they say, rise up. When you're living on your knees, you rise up. Tell your brother that he's got to rise up. Tell your sister that she's got to rise up. When are these colonies going to rise up? Sadly, there was one institution that continued during the Enlightenment, especially in the American South. Anybody know what that is? Yes, you can say that about slavery, yeah. And we know in North Carolina they had it some time ago, but. One thing the musical clearly demonstrates is Hamilton's profound hatred of slavery, both in theory and practice. He was both immoral and impractical. And his best friend from the South, John Lawrence, actually in South Carolina, sings, but we will never be truly free until those in bondage have the same rights as you and me, you and I, do or die. Wait till I sally in on a stallion with the first black battalion. And Hamilton joins Lawrence in this battle for new ideas of liberty and individualism, which rejects collectivism and racism. And he says, popping the squat on conventional wisdom, like it or not, a bunch of revolutionary manumission abolitionists, give me a position, show me where the ammunition is. He wants to blast slavery back into the Stone Age. Hamilton as a constitutionalist. Contrary to popular belief, July 4th, 1776, although here a heroic and pivotal moment in world history, was not the birth of America. It was simply a divorce from Britain by 13 free and independent states. It was in 1789, after ratification of the U.S. Constitution, that the country was born. The states were finally united, and Hamilton is the one that put the U in USA. But what kind of country would America be? That answer comes in Act Two of the musical, when we see the two foremost intellectuals in America square off. Which two am I talking about? Yes, Thomas Jefferson and Alexander Hamilton. When Act Two opens, we get to see Jefferson for the first time since he's been away in France for several years. And the two opponents present their ideas of both domestic and foreign policy by having two cabinet meeting rap battles. George Washington moderates each one. And we're going to actually listen to the first one, which focuses on domestic policy.
Ladies and gentlemen, you could have been anywhere in the world tonight, but you're here with us in New York City. Are you ready for a cabinet meeting? The issue on the table. Secretary Hamilton's plan to assume state debt and establish a national bank. Secretary Jefferson, you have the floor, sir.
Life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness. We fought for these ideals, we shouldn't settle for less. These are wise words, enterprising men quote them. Don't act surprised, you guys, because I wrote them. Now, but Hamilton forgets. His plan would have the government assume state debt. Now, place your bets as to who that benefits. Look, every seat of government where Hamilton sits.
Not true.
Ooh, if the shoe fits, wear it. If New York's in debt, why should Virginia bear it? Our debts are paid, I'm afraid. Don't tax the South, because we got it made in the shade. In Virginia, we plant seeds in the ground. We create. You just want to move our money around. This financial plan is an outrageous demand, and it's too many damn pages for any man to understand. Stand with me in the land of the free. Pray to God we never see Hamilton's candidacy. Look, when Britain taxed our tea, we got free. whatever gonna happen when you try to tax our whiskey.
Thank you, Secretary Jefferson. Secretary Hamilton, your response. Thomas, that was a real nice declaration. Welcome to the present, we're running a real nation. Would you like to join us? We're staying mellow, doing whatever the hell it is you do in Monticello. If we assume the debts the union gets, a numerator credit, a financial diuretic, how do you not get it? If we're aggressive and competitive, the union gets a bonus, you'd rather give it a sedative. A civics lesson from a slave, or hey neighbor, your debts are paid because you don't pay for labor. We plant seeds in the south, we create and keep ranting. We know who's really doing the planting. And another thing, Mr. Age of Enlightenment, don't lecture me about the war. You didn't fight in it. You think I'm fighting everywhere? We almost died in the trench. Well, you were off getting high with the French. Thomas Jefferson always hesitant with the president. Medicine, there isn't a plan he doesn't get into. Medicine, new matters, I have this, so take your medicine. Damn, you in worse shape than the national deficit. Sitting there useless as two shits. Hey, turn around, bend over, I'll show you where my shoe fits. Excuse me.
You guys like that? Good. Now, Jefferson's land of the free includes slaves who toil under his own hand. The South's got it made in the shade only through this feudal, agrarian, slave-driven system in which merchants and banks are despised because they just move more money around. Hamilton turns to a related economic issue of paying off the war debt, which at the time was actually so high that even the interest wasn't being paid off. And most of the founders just wanted to forget about it, kind of like start all over again. But Hamilton's fiscally responsible stance clarifies this topic. And he knows that it's both moral to pay off your debts, but also practical because you establish credit by doing so. And if anyone at the time understood the perils of financial disunity and a weak economy for a fledgling nation, it was Hamilton. He had already proven that with the Bank of New York. Next, we move on to foreign policy. In cabinet battle number two, the year 1793, and Jefferson wants to uphold a prior treaty with France, regardless of the current reign of terror during the French Revolution. Through all the mob rule and heads rolling in the street, Thomas Jefferson always admired the French Revolution. However, Hamilton says, we signed a treaty with a king whose head is now in a basket. Would you like to take it out and ask it? Should we honor a treaty, King Louis's head? Do whatever you want, I'm super dead. And Washington becomes frustrated with his fellow Virginian, whose his idealism blinds him to reality. So he asks Hamilton to draft a statement of neutrality. Why this proclamation of neutrality? Because the two Revolutionary War heroes knew that European nations had fought for centuries. France and England had 100-year wars, and they would likely continue to do so, mainly because they don't understand individual rights. Sadly, many people today, even in America, don't understand individual rights. So the policy there instead would be to avoid entanglement altogether, because it did not serve America's self-interest. Imagine where we'd be today if we didn't become involved in foreign entanglements. America at its best is Hamiltonian. And this is most obvious in the North, especially New York, where there's commercial, manufacturing, and financial institutions which uphold property rights and the sanctity of contract. A free system based on merit, where even orphan immigrants could rise up. Now you can see the contrast in the map where we start out. There's only a few slave states, but as we go on 1821 and then building right up to 1860 and the Civil War, slavery just continued to expand. And Hamilton predicted this would happen 60 years before the actual Civil War. And he believed that the free, commercial, pro-military North would defeat the Southern, feudal, Jeffersonian South and wipe out slavery. America was most Hamiltonian and the freest period in the world post-Civil War, where people came from all over the globe for the land of opportunity. Hamilton's America leapfrogged over other countries, all other countries, in terms of industrial production, innovation, and increased living standards. Now, with all Hamilton and Jefferson disagreed fundamentally on outlook, occasionally they did work together. For instance, they compromised about moving the U.S. Capitol from New York City to a swampland in Northern Virginia. Still a swampland. And that's what Jefferson wanted, in exchange for getting sufficient votes for having the federal government assume the state's debts, which is what Hamilton wanted. So remember the importance of paying off your debts. Actually, that should be personally important, because once you do that, you establish credit. And that's something that is very beneficial in the future. And then the second thing is, frankly, moral, to pay off your debts. And after this agreement is made during in the musical, Hamilton tells a befuddled and jealous Aaron Burr, I haven't even gotten to him yet. He says, we'll have the banks, we're in the same spot. I wanted what I got. God help and forgive me. I want to build something that's going to outlive me. More long-range thinking here by Hamilton, as he hailed the pro-immigrant, pro-Wall Street commercial center of New York, which his opponents derided as Hamiltonopolis. I take offense to that because of the lifelong New York. Now, one of the greatest acts of justice in the musical is that Hamilton's story finally does get told. And it's such a powerfully dramatic medium by a brilliant storyteller. As I said in the opening, since Hamilton had many opponents, Jefferson, Madison, Adams, Monroe, who took advantage of his untimely death, they largely rewrote his story, portraying him as a bastard rabbit, Scotch peddler, an aristocrat who favors the moneyed interest and calls the public a great beast. But we could first thank his wife, Eliza, for rectifying this injustice. She outlived him by 50 years and witnessed the mythological distortion of his character and ideas while seeing the country increasingly divide over slavery in the South and industrialism in the North. Eliza went through Hamilton's papers, interviewed associates who served with him in War and Peace, and did her best to set the record straight. Inspired by Ron Chernow's biography, Lin-Manuel Miranda masterfully seizes the reins, taking the next step in doing right by Hamilton. He retells his story in America from the beginning. Theatrically, 1776 New York City is where the two future duelists meet. And the young, naive Hamilton is grateful to track down the murderer. And after a barrage of words and ideas from the excited upstart, Burr offers this advice. Talk less, smile more. Don't let them know what you're against or what you're for. Sounds like today's politicians, right? And Hamilton says, can't be serious. So right from the get-go, 5 minutes into the musical, the stage is literally set for two opposing philosophies. One sitting on the fence, waiting to see which way the wind blows, the other standing on principle, on first-handed judgment, regardless of how unpopular that might be. We also see Hamilton's productiveness and integrity as Act One concludes. And Burr's uncontainable envy of Hamilton escalates in the song Nonstop. He says, even though we started at the very same time, Alexander Hamilton began to climb. How to account for his rise to the top? Man, the man is nonstop. And then he continues, why do you always say what you believe? Every proclamation guarantees free ammunition for your enemies. How do you write like you needed to survive? How do you write it the second you're alive? And while this is going on, we see Hamilton writing what we now know as the Federalist Papers. And he's reading books, and he's just using his mind. The entire show is about the mind of this brilliant man. When invited by Hamilton to join him in defending the proposed U.S. Constitution, to share in the risk and the glory, Burr refuses, and Hamilton can't understand it. He says, Burr, we studied and we fought and we killed for the notion of a nation we now get to build. But once in your life, take a stand with pride. I don't understand how you stand to the side. So producing something of lasting value requires taking that principled stand, which Hamilton does repeatedly, much to the benefit of his countrymen and their descendants. That's us, we are his descendants. We live in his country. The musical also covers several pivotal moments in Hamilton's life, his personal life, his marriage, family, friendship, blackmail, but we don't have time to go into that. At the climax, Burr loses his bid for wider political power and he blames Hattington for all of his failures. And he challenges him to a duel. I like this rap battle because Hattington was found with the New York Post, but I don't think that was the headline back then. Hamilton accepts the duel, but unfortunately, he does throw his shot away by firing up in the air, merely because he doesn't think the sitting vice president, can you imagine Joe Biden shooting someone? I can't imagine. But he's going to lose his spot, someone who's very politically ambitious. Hamilton did not think that he would shoot to kill, but that's exactly what Burr does. And the silent audience is gripped. The first one to step forward is President Washington, who says, "Let me tell you what I wish I'd known when I was young and dreamed of glory. You have no control who lives, who dies, who tells your story." Next is President Jefferson, who says, "I'll give him this. His financial system is a work of genius. I couldn't undo it if I tried, and I tried." Next is President Madison, who says, "He took our country from bankruptcy to prosperity. I hate to admit it, but he doesn't get enough credit for the credit he gave us." Next is Hamilton's sister-in-law, Angelica, who says, "Every other founding father story gets told. Every other founding father gets to grow old. And when you're gone, who remembers your name, who keeps your flame, who tells your story?" Each pronouncement is an act of justice, culminating with Eliza getting in the last word for her fallen hero. She says, "You could have done so much more if you only had time. And when my time is up, have I done enough? Will they tell our story?" Yes, Eliza, your story is told. More than anything else, this musical is about Hamilton's legacy. Early in Act One, he ventures, "Don't be shocked when the history book mentions me. I will lay down my life if it sets us free. Eventually, you'll see my ascendancy." And after Hamilton has ascended and achieved many of those million things he hadn't done, he muses in the last moments of his life about the nature of a legacy. Legacy, what is a legacy? It's planting seeds in a garden you never get to see. I wrote some notes at the beginning of a song someone will sing for me. "America, you great unfinished symphony, you sent for me. You let me make a difference, a place where even orphan immigrants can leave their fingerprints and rise up." What is that legacy? Federalist Papers, Bank of New York, New York Stock Exchange, West Point, U.S. Customs House, U.S. Coast Guard, U.S. Constitution. If you look at any skyline in America, you will see Hamilton's legacy. None more so than his hometown of New York. 1835, after his financial policies had paid off the national debt, merchants commissioned a 14-foot marble statue, first marble statue ever built in America. And they placed it on the rotunda of the Stock Exchange in Lower Manhattan. So merchants, when he was young, sent for him to come to America, and then after he died, they honored him by building the statue. Sadly, it lasted less than 1 year. It was destroyed by the Great Fire of New York. But now there are several monuments of Hamilton in New York. Four statues, the Grange up in Harlem, where he lived the last few years of his life. It's actually the neighborhood called Hamilton Heights. And it's no accident that he is buried, literally buried on Wall Street, down at Trinity Church. After Hamilton's abolitionist dreams played out post-Civil War, the United States did enjoy that industrial revolution, which he envisioned. Innovations in industries such as transportation and communication, financed by investors, managed by entrepreneurs, produced a level of prosperity never seen before in history. And as the 19th century closed, a monument dedicated to the individuals who had the most positive impact was built, the Hall of Fame for Great Americans in the Bronx. Hamilton was among the first names to be nominated. One of the catalysts who made the 1920s roar was President Calvin Coolidge, who properly claimed the business of America is business. This statement could have been uttered by Hamilton. In fact, Coolidge admired Hamilton so much that he had his image printed on a $10 bill. $10 founding father would have been proud to see the seeds that he had planted so long ago. Hamilton, an American musical, is poised to usher in another era of that legacy, with audiences, particularly 20,000 New York City high school students, who will learn about this hero. The future of America and New York is looking bright. Yes, the CD cast recording, which we will be raffling off later on, is a superb alternative for those of you who cannot make it up to New York City and see the show, which, by the way, is sold out through next March. And as soon as the next batch of tickets go on sale, it'll sell out again. The buzz that is created there it's astounding. I'm a lifelong New Yorker. I've been to Broadway shows my entire life, and I can't describe the proper recognition that it's getting. Hamilton's heroism can be summarized in one verse from the song Hurricane. I wrote my way out of hell. I wrote my way to revolution. I was louder than the crack in the bell. I wrote about the Constitution and defended it well. And in the face of ignorance and resistance, I wrote financial systems into existence. And when my prayers to God were met with indifference, I picked up a pen. I wrote my own deliverance. Three takeaways. Number one, Hamilton is a self-made man. His heroic actions inspire us to reach for more in our own lives. Two, America at its best is Hamiltonian. Uphold the Constitution, free trade, industry, finance, against slavery and foreign entanglements. And number three, Hamilton did rewrite the game. By telling his story properly, we get to learn that. And his legacy is all around us, so enjoy it. Now, what will the legacy of Hamilton in American musical be? Well, some of the most powerful messages in the musical are: do not throw away your shot. Put a pencil to your temple and connect it to your brain. Stay alive. Don't live on your knees. Rise up. Pursue nonstop achievement. Write love letters to your loved ones. Take a stand with pride. Start reading every treatise on the shelf. Work a lot harder. Be a lot smarter. Be a self-starter. Pick up a pen and write your own deliverance. And although you may not live to see the glory, your own glory, join in the fight. Build something that's going to outlive you. And if you do that on the grand scale, history just might have its eyes on you. Thank you.
So
we have time for any questions?
Yeah, I believe we have 10, 15 minutes for questions. Does anyone else have any question you want to bounce off just directly here? No?
So thank you for the comments. This is a fascinating topic.
Thank you.
Hamilton wasn't necessarily against all foreign immigrants. He was against him getting involved in European wars necessarily, but his idea was that commerce would be spread, that we should spread our commerce globally and use of force if necessary in certain circumstances.
Give me an example of that.
Now, this is where I might be off base. This is the Alexander Hamilton Society Charter. Yeah. So it would be with the, like, for example, and this might be too much later, but his promotion of trade with Canada and generally how he navigated that relationship. But correct me if I'm wrong, and I'm maybe speaking out of turn.
Okay, so first of all, trade and force are opposites. One is a voluntary consent. Trade is voluntary consent, and dealing with somebody by force is a different, you know, that's the opposite of the type of relationship. So, I'm not aware of that. I'll just tell you that I don't know. Certainly, the French Revolution was the most common, the most concrete example, and that's why he recommended this proclamation of neutrality, and that became America's policy. That essentially became America's foreign policy. So the Monroe Doctrine actually elaborated on that and said that we, not only will we not get involved in foreign entanglements, foreign wars, but you Europeans cannot come over here and colonize and do any more colonizations in this hemisphere, Western hemisphere. But I have to admit, I don't know of any examples of that. I can refer to the Hamilton super duper expert even more than me, Professor Sullivan.
Just quickly, if you mean trade, he was all for free trade. So by not entangling, he didn't mean block off and protectionist
Donald Trump type right. He wanted trade, you know, Canada, Britain, France, the entanglements they're warning against are military, mostly military, you know, where you take a side and back France, and if so, you're going to be in a war with Britain if you back Britain militarily. But so maybe that's your confusion. If you mean, you know, he wasn't against entanglements, if you mean trade, yes, he wanted trade, but he didn't call those entanglements, he called them, you know, beneficial commercial arrangements. They weren't military deals, they were people just trading over the border.
But how did you get trade at the time? You have to have merchant marines, you have to have a stronger navy to protect your ship. So even at the time, I don't think trade in the military is the opposite. I think there was an aspect of trade that involved protection of the century.
Yes, but not an alliance, an entangling alliance. They advocated that the Navy is in the Constitution. The Coast Guard, yeah, for purposes of protecting trade and keeping it from being invaded militarily.
That's right. I mean, there's an example why we went to war. The Barbary Pirates War was because American ships were being attacked and held hostage by in the Mediterranean. So that's an example where you do need the military to protect the business that's happening, international business. So yeah, he saw a global economy. That's how far ahead Hamilton was ahead of the curve. Yes, you have a question.
Okay, thank you so much for your talk. So we talk about a lot of the positive legacies Hamilton has made.
Yes.
But would you elaborate some negative aspect of his life? For example, I heard like he tried to manipulate Washington after he retired from presidency.
Yes, that's part of, I didn't bring the book with me, but there's an excellent book called Alexander Hamilton and the Persistence of Myth by Stephen Knott. And he describes, from the day Hamilton died, his legacy was twisted by his opponents, and again, who outlived him by many years. And he had an incredible relationship with Washington. Sadly, some of the founders were very jealous, particularly Adams and Jefferson were very jealous of Washington's well-deserved popularity. So what they did, they tried to attack Washington, and they saw that backfired. So instead, they attacked the ones beneath him who were less popular. And George Washington's last letter he ever wrote was praising Hamilton for the idea of adopting the West Point Military Academy. So they always had an incredibly positive relationship with each other, even though they differ. I mean, there's one difference I could say that it's kind of alluded to in the musical. Hamilton thought if the black soldiers who fought in the Revolutionary War, if America won, they should be granted their freedom. And sadly, Washington disagreed with him, and that did not happen. But I think Hamilton rubbed off on him because when Washington, upon his death, he left in his will to free his own slaves. So, but Washington is often, he's been criticized as a tool of Hamilton, or as that he was senile, and that was not the case. That was definitely not the case. If you do ask me though, what criticism are there of Hamilton? He definitely had some flaws. I mean, he had an affair that backfired on him, and he was blackmailed twice by having this affair, and it just proves that even though it was more important for Hamilton's public image to be maintained than did not embezzle treasury funds. He was paying his husband as a bribe, but that eventually came out, and so it did leave a bad taste on a lot of people's minds. But whatever flaws that Hamilton had, I say they're minuscule by comparison. They're absolutely his achievement is so staggering that his flaws they're not okay. Yes.
So I completely agree with everything you said. Thank you very much. But it still seems to me hard to deny a little bit of attraction with Hamilton's kind of the British way of doing things, right? And in fact, many prominent Hamiltonians in the succeeding decades have been very much for kind of U.S. relations with Britain rather than France. And Hamilton was very much for kind of these honorific titles for the U.S. presidency, and some of them help even regard himself sort of like a bit of the equivalent of the British prime minister serving under the king, right?
Yeah.
So what do you make of those?
Okay, so the first thing is that let's look at Britain, which was on the verge of its own industrial revolution, which Britain was the greatest country in the world. whatever they were doing to the colonies was minuscule compared to the bloodshed that was happening everywhere else. And the alternative was a French Revolution where heads are rolling in the street every 5 minutes. All right? So that was why Hamilton leaned more towards the British. But he wanted, Ron Chernow says this beautifully in his book on Hamilton, he says he wanted to emulate the British system, but with American means so that we could overtake them. Okay, so they had a good model, starting from their Magna Carta all the way up. The concept of rights essentially originated in Britain. So there was a lot of good for America to emulate. And Hamilton saw that. But this idea, the thing where I don't necessarily agree with is that most people think that automatically means monarchy, that he advocated a monarchy, or a king. That's another common misconception about him. And so one reason to emulate Britain, that, you know, the way that I see it is that they were the best country in the world, aside from America, especially for an infant country to be modeled after someone. But again, my point is that because America was born out of the Enlightenment, Britain was born during the urge of monarchy and Christianity, steeped in the culture.